Greetings, Earthlings! Today I'm back with a review of a brand new audio interface from Focusrite. So today we're reviewing this guy, the Focusrite Scarlett 2i2 third gen. That is right, the third generation of this Scarlett series. If you do want to pick this interface up, it will set you back around $160. Like always, I'll throw some links down below. And in the sake of full disclosure, Focusrite did send me this interface for the sake of doing this review. For this review, I have the Rode NT1 connected directly to the 3rd Gen Scarlett 2i2 with the 48 volts phantom power turned on and the gain set at around 50%. I will not do any kind of post-processing, but I may boost it in post, so check the doobly-doo to see what I diddly did. Now let's talk about what comes in the box. Of course, you are going to get the interface. You'll get a USB-C to USB-A cable. You also get some free software like Pro Tools First, Ableton Live Lite, SoftTube, Focusrite's Red Plugin Suite, and a whole lot more. And that is actually all you get in the box. All the downloads, like the documentation, the drivers, the software, it's all downloadable on Focusrite's website. Next up, as far as the build quality, the audio interface feels really well put together, just like all the other Focusrite interfaces I've tested in the past. It does have an all-metal chassis on the tops and the sides, while the back and the front are made of plastic. The dials don't have any kind of wobble to them. The buttons have a really nice tactile click to them, so you know when you've pressed one. The XLR ports have no movement to them that is out of the ordinary. And very quickly, the 3rd Gen 2i2 is actually a touch smaller than the 2nd Gen. Width-wise and height-wise, it is the exact same, but when we look at the depth, it is just a little bit more shallow. On the front of the interface, you're going to find two identical channels. They each have an XLR combo jack for either an XLR or quarter-inch input. They also both have a gain dial with a ring meter light around it, which will flash red when you start clipping, so you know you need to roll back the gain at that point. They also have an instrument button to switch between line level and instrument level when you're using the quarter inch input. And the really cool feature in this interface is the addition of the air button, which is a circuit that's found in Focusrite's higher end ISA preamps. When you move farther to the right, you'll find a 48 volt phantom power button to turn on or off the phantom power. They've also added a new direct monitor button so you can turn on or off direct monitoring, but you're also able to monitor stuff as mono or as a stereo pair in case you're running a stereo microphone set and you would want to hear the sound that you're actually recording. The 3rd Gen has a very similar monitor dial to turn up or down the quarter inch inputs on the rear. It has a headphone volume control and a quarter inch stereo headphone output. Then on the back of the interface, you'll find a USB-C port to connect it to your device, which is just awesome to see. I think we should USB-C all the things, and you'll find a set of balanced quarter inch monitor outputs. Then, as far as the specs of this thing, it has a bit depth of 24-bit and a sampling rate of up to 192 kHz, a gain range of 56 decibels with a dynamic range of 111 decibels, and when I measure the phantom power, it comes in just shy of 48 volts at around 47.1. And really quickly, up on the screen, I have a comparison of the 3rd Gen 2i2 to the 2nd Gen 2i2, so you're able to see what the differences in the specifications are. Okay, so right now I am right on top of the NT1 to really engage the proximity effect, and I do not have the air circuit turned on, and this is how it's sounding. And now I've enabled the air circuit, and this is how it's sounding, and you should be able to hear quite a big boost in the upper frequencies that just really brightens up the sound. For another demonstration of the air circuit, I am speaking into the SM7B again. I do not have the air circuit currently turned on, and this is how it's sounding. And now I've enabled the air circuit, and you can hear that it really brightens up the SM7B quite a lot. Now let's go ahead and measure the noise floor of one of these preamps, and for that I will be using a method that I learned from Julian Krauss. I will link his video in the upper corner if you want to check that out. Now, in order to really test out the preamps in this thing, I've connected the Shure SM7B, which is a notoriously quiet microphone. I've increased my gain nearly to 100%, and I am hitting around negative 6 dB on my meters, and this is how it's sounding, and I will be quiet so you can hear what kind of background noise there is. Now, with a sample rate of 48 kHz and an I/O buffer size of 64 samples, we have a round-trip latency of 8 milliseconds or an output latency of 3.5 milliseconds. If we jump up to 128 samples, we have 10.5 milliseconds round-trip or 4.5 milliseconds output. And if we jump up to 256 samples, we have 16 milliseconds round-trip or 7.5 milliseconds output. Now, with a sample rate of 192 kHz and an I/O buffer size of 64 samples, we have a round-trip latency of 6 milliseconds or an output latency of 2.3 milliseconds. If we jump up to 128 samples, we have 6.5 milliseconds round-trip or 2.5 milliseconds output. And if we jump up to 256 samples, we have 8 milliseconds round-trip or 3.3 milliseconds output. And finally, I want to demonstrate the instrument input of this interface, so I'll be plugging my guitar directly into this thing. I'll start by playing the DI track with no amp simulator on, then I will turn on the air circuit so you can hear how that affects the electric guitar as just a DI signal, then I'll turn on the amp simulator so you can hear it with and without the air circuit and see how it sounds. And now I want to do a very quick comparison of the noise performance and the max gain on tap of the 2i2 second gen to the 2i2 third gen and see how they match up. So there you have it. I don't know about you guys, but I didn't hear or see much of a difference in terms of the max gain available or the noise floor of the 2i2 second gen versus the 2i2 third gen. All right. I think that Focusrite was really smart about the incremental upgrades that they made to the 2i2 third gen without really losing sight of who it was for. It just seems to do everything that you'd need an interface to do, and it does it really well. And we'll start with the pros, and first up we got the high-res recording up to 24-bit 192 kHz. I also found the preamps to be pretty dang clean, even when we were nearing 100% while driving the SM7B, which was great to hear. There was also ample headroom when I was plugging my instruments directly into this thing, meaning I wasn't running into issues with clipping, which has been an issue on some other low-cost interfaces. The latency performance of this thing also was pretty impressive, and the headphone amp I found to be a little bit less noisy than the 2i2 second gen, and you also get the ability to direct monitor in either mono or stereo, which is really important, especially if you are setting up a stereo microphone set. And lastly, you're getting access to that air circuit, which previously had just been reserved for Focusrite's higher-end preamps. And then in terms of cons, there's not much that I can complain about this thing, but if I were to get nitpicky, I am not the biggest fan of the metering lights on this because it just doesn't give me a level of granularity that I like. I would like to be able to know what level I'm hitting without having to pull up a DAW or a meter in some software. And additionally, to get really, really nitpicky, I personally prefer to have a physical mix dial that allows me to mix between the zero latency monitoring and the computer playback, which unfortunately is not on this device. And to wrap up, would I recommend the 2i2 third gen? Absolutely, I would. I legitimately think that for home studio musicians and podcasters, it does everything that you would need an entry-level audio interface to do. And the reason that I say that is it has great preamps, it can record high-res audio, it has ample headroom so you can DI your instruments and record directly into your DAW, and it has low enough latency that you can monitor some amp sims that you're running through your computer, and lastly, it has balanced monitor outputs. Now, with all of that being said, if you're currently running the 2i2 second gen and you don't absolutely need the new air circuit or the stereo direct monitoring, you don't need to upgrade because the preamp performance from the 2i2 second gen to the 2i2 third gen really isn't that different. But on the other hand, if you are on the market for a new interface around $150, maybe you were previously looking at the second gen version of this interface, then absolutely I would recommend picking up the third gen because you are getting that new added air circuit and you now have the added ability to direct monitor stuff in stereo if you are stereo miking anything. All right, and that is going to wrap up for today. So if you found this video fun, interesting, or helpful, go ahead and give me a thumbs up. If you hated it, give me a big old thumbs down. Want more videos? You can subscribe by clicking that logo down beneath me. And don't forget to hit that bell icon. If you don't get enough of me here, go ahead and check out my podcast. You can find that at bandrewsays.com. And you can also check out my podcast network at geeksrising.com. I'll see y'all next time. Thanks for watching. Thanks for listening. Bye.